So, so this is a title of the. I slightly changed it a little bit, but not that I would like to change it, but I somehow didn't look at the program of the meeting of the workshop, and so I was thinking I'm lecturing on this, but on the next slide you will see that I didn't change anything. This is my joint work with Patricio Sonado Mendez, who is my canonical co-author, or one of my canonical co-authors recently. He's both in Paris and in Prague. And as usually, I start the lecture by showing the place where I usually work, you know, and just to get you the feeling that Berkeley is not the only place on the earth which is nice, you know. And, it's about randomness and versus sparse structure. It's this randomness is a little bit unusual in this context, as you will see. I mean, that's the structure is I think dominant in this context. I somehow collected some results which are related to it, and it leads to an interesting problem, and actually it's leading to problems which showing what is the right somehow attitude. The graphs, everything will be about graphs, and graphs are meant as an examples because you can generalize most of these things to something else. So let's try to be patient for one, two slides. I mean, this is really pedestrian graph theory. I mean, so you say that H is a topological minor of a graph. If it is a subdivision if there is a subdivision of the graph H, which is appearing as a subgraph in the graph G. So H may be much smaller than the graph G, and the depth of the and this is sort of key definition of the depth of the subdivision is just the number of points which you are adding on the edges, maximum number. Yeah. So you say it is in this case we would say the it is in depth 3 probably. Yeah. Because you I or depth C certainly, maybe depth 2 even. So it's usually scaled by half, you know, from some reason, because if you are speaking about not a topological minor but about a vertex minor, then it somehow gets more synchronized. And so we speak then about a shallow topological minor and depths R. I think this shallow minors, I mean, this is a little theory which developed from it. I think it maybe started here in Berkeley because it was Rao, Smith, and Thurston and Miller came with the notion in the context of studying densities of intersection graphs of geometrical objects. I mean, so which is very much in the line of the. So we know what is. This shallow topological minor, and here is the definition of this bounded expansion. So it's about graph properties. So we speak about some. We know it's not that one graph would have a bounded expansion, but I mean the class or some property of graphs has a bounded expansion if leads it from the bottom, right? We define it by means of degeneration. So we say that a graph is degenerated if there exists some ordering of vertices so that number of arcs going to the left is bounded. Yeah. It has other names too, but it's like in coloring number of the graph. The graph is, in this case, it will be 3 degenerated because it has ordering, so that the number of arcs going to the, or number of edges going to the left is bounded. And I will say that this class has a bounded expansion if there exists some function. If arbitrary, maybe arbitrary growing, it's necessary that it may grow arbitrarily. It may be super exponential, it may be tower function. There are examples like that. which has the property that if I fix an R, which is the depth of the minor, then for any graph G, the shallow topological any shallow topological minor of the graph is degenerated with this function value fr. Yeah. So in other words, at a given depth, a given r, all the graphs in my class at a given which are minors at a given depth are sparse in the sense they are degenerated. They have a small degrees to the left. Yeah. Mind you that that the degeneracy doesn't mean that the degree is bounded, right? I mean, any tree is one degenerated, you know, any planar graph is five degenerated. I mean, so it's any graph on given surface is degenerate. So this is by now sort of a standard notation how you can treat it by material. We don't need it. So this bounded expansion is quite a broad property, in fact the original motivation was to somehow to encompass the algorithms which were appearing in various areas of the combinatorial and graph theory situation. I mean that, of course, the bounded expansion contains topological closed properties. It contains planar graphs, but even some more exotic like bounded crossing number, bounded number of crossing per edge, and all above, and more exotic. Well, and as well, a random graph. Yeah. And that I will explain now a little bit. It's an easy theorem, I mean, which is claiming, well, so these graphs, I mean, one more thing, yeah, and that's important, to say. This bounded expansion is a notion which is on one side covering, there are two main lines of the, on one side it's covering graphs which are, or classes which are closed on the minors, or topological minors. On other side, it covers graphs which have a bounded degree. Yeah. Because if you take the shallow minor, then of the radius r, then you are contracting only bounded neighborhood, which has a bounded size if it is bounded by a bounded degree. And so this function, this expanding function, what was on previous slides, fr, is growing exponentially, but it's fixed for any given depth. And of course, I mean, in a graph theory, the graphs which are regular and graphs which are somehow geometrically represented are very much different. I mean, there are not too many results which they would have in common. Nevertheless, from the algorithmic point of view and from this point of view, they are unified by this concept. So how is it with this random graph? This is easy theorem, which is saying that if the graph has an edge probability, a random graph GNDN for any d fixed is asymptotic almost surely has a bounded expansion. So I mean, so how I should understand it? I'm showing that there are some values. I mean, of this function which are defining this expansion function and the growth of this of degrees parameters, which are implying that the class of all graphs which are satisfying is a bounded expansion, and these graphs with this probability d of n are asymptotically almost surely fit belonging to this class. So it's this is sort of optimistic in a way, because I mean they are highly structured classes, but never, at least we know that this canonical random class of random graphs belong there. I mean, this can be refined, and this is negative. This is pessimistic, in a way, title. You can refine it that if you take a given graph which has maximum degree bounded, this is the G, and you add to it edges which are generated in random with this probability d over n, you still get a graph with a bounded expansion. Yeah, so that's, at one time we call it liquid graphs. I think these are basically the graphs where you plant this bounded degree graph and then you extend it to this random graph. So maybe it's better to call it differently. But it's the same proof. I mean there's a paper on it, and we put it in our book as an exercise. I mean, so that's to check that this is this class of such a liquid graphs with over bounded degree graph is has a bounded expansion. So what's negative on it? Well, no, negative on it that this is in a way best possible, because one would somehow like, and this is showing the sensitivity of the notion to randomness, which is maybe unfortunate, so that because one would like to have take a bounded expansion class and perturb it a little bit by d over n, and you still get a bounded expansion. And that's deeply not true, as showing by the example of a tree. So if you take this is a star system. I mean, take a square root of n stars, each of them square root of size square root of n, and take the probability d over n, and then you get a complete graph in a random, almost surely in the graph if you contract if you subdivide or contract two neighborhood of the of a graph. So, and of course, you want to keep the trees as a bounded expansion class. This is sort of a basic type of graph. So this it's not true that, and in fact, this is sort of showing that this is in a way best possible. I will still return to this bounded expansion, but allow me to say a little detour. And I'm happy that I'm lecturing after the lecture of Mariaris in the morning, because it's actually what I'm talking is actually very much related to that lecture. And it's by means of this notion which is somehow related and which is slightly more general than this bounded expansion. Yeah. So in the bounded expansion, we were assuming that these graphs which we get as shallow minors have a bounded degrees in a way. Not bounded degree, but they are degenerated. Now, I mean, example of the graph which has all degrees bounded, it's a complete graph. So let's forbid it. I mean, let's take a class of graphs which don't contain an every depth, don't contain a complete graph. Yeah. And that's a call that has a name, and I know we know where dense graphs, and this is extremely robust notion. I mean, this is virtually every combinatorial parameter which exists can be modified in order to get characterization. Exactly, not something which is related. Exactly the characterization of the space. It can be defined by covering. It may be defined by counting. It may be by packing. And in fact, if you assume mild condition just that it is monotone, so it's closed on the non-induced subgraphs, then it is exactly the same thing as the stable classes, which in the sense of Shellac, which we had in the morning. It has the same, it can be described by VC dimension. I mean, it may be defined by algorithms, I mean modulo some complexity, fixed parameter tractability or no tractability hypothesis. I mean, so it can be defined locally, I mean, as in the spirit of these edge densities which were before. Maybe defined by limits, which is very recent results which we obtained, which is very analytic description of it. The graph is the class is somewhere dense if and only if it has every converging sequence as a modeling. And so there are many characterization. I think this is the main importance of the thing is just coming from this large spectrum of the thing. And I will mention only a few of it. I mean, oh, this is a propaganda. So that, and so the same thing can be said about the I mean, this threshold for the nowhere dense can be achieved in a similar method for the nowhere dense and. Nowhere written, but I mean it's a routine to obtain. I want to say one application of it. I mean, so, and it's a result, a recent I think problem of Joel, that assume that three colorability is non-trivial for some D. So the let's say dB and such, so it's a threshold. We such that the three colorability of the graph G and D is a non-trivial. Rather than asking, asking whether there is a polynomial algorithm which decides this three colorability for these classes, for these random. Yeah. So I mean, we cannot solve the problem, but we can show that. And I mean, sort of, I think the answer should be no. At least that's what I believe. I mean that, or we believe. And but we show that there are edge coloring problems which have these properties. I mean, and that's maybe leading to the right conjecture, which is related to the problem. And here is the theorem. So this is the most technical slide of. My lecture. So fix a D, yeah, and fix a odd integer, it will be odd cycle. Yeah. Then there exists a fixed graph, the DP, so maybe much larger, very large, it may be, maybe exponentially large, which has odd Gers greater than P, which has the following property, yeah, that for these graphs is color, so this is the H, right? So the H coloring, so DDP colorability, is asymptotically almost surely equivalent to the odd Gers greater than P. So which means that this is a non-trivial problem because we know the probability that the graph contains odd cycle of the greater than something, and the second is that there is even a linear algorithm which is giving this H coloring, well, not a linear algorithm which I mean it's an algorithm which is providing the answer in the following sense. So if there is probability zero, it says I don't know. I mean it. Or it can find an odd cycle of the length that means P, or it can exhibit a homomorphism, so it means H coloring of the graph. And so this is, I mean, what would Joe like to have? Would he like to have it for triangle, right? DDP, if that it would. Something like it should hold for the triangle, yeah. And assuming that it is non-trivial, then there exists and there is some polynomial algorithm. Yeah. This is not so easy, theorem. So this DDP is the existence of DDP is not so easy to find. And in fact, one is using this this result about bounded expansion classes, about they can be this graph DDP are bounded have a bounded expansion. This is called a restricted dual. If something is bounded expansion, then it has so-called all restricted dualities. So for any whenever we forbid some finitely many graphs, there is always this graph on the right hand side, this dual. So this is particular case for odd cycle of the length p. And still, this is sort of important example because the existence for odd cycles, in fact, is almost equivalent to the general graphs, and certainly in this case, it is the case. And then there is one can have for that this one can have a linear algorithm for such a coloring because this is in fact in general there is a linear algorithm for bounded expansion classes, which is this model checking linear algorithm which was conjectured for several years, and it was proved by Dvořák, Král, and Robin Thomas. So we can find such a linear algorithm. So it's the essential part of it is so-called low tree depth decomposition, which is existence of which is linear. So the conjecture, it's leading to the following conjecture. Yeah. Which may even classify the situation So suppose that the H coloring is non-trivial on the graph, and so then the following statements could be equivalent. So it's a conjecture. So there exists a polynomial algorithm for H coloring with epsilon color, and basically, without reading it, let me say we believe that this is covering all the positive situations like that. Yeah. So basically all the instances where we have this polynomial algorithm, then we have a linear algorithm even, and that this linear algorithm is corresponding to the H, which is produced in the following way by means of a dual. So let's formulate it let's read it as it is now here. So there is a polynomial algorithm for H coloring, there is even linear algorithm, either it is H or H is restricted dual for some odd cycle, and H coloring has a coarse threshold. And I believe this implication, one should say, it's I think in a hopeful way. I think the Friedgood-Bourgain result is actually showing that 3 and 4 are equivalent. Using it in the context of this restricted dual, because they somehow the coarse threshold are defined by means of. By means of some small finite family, and so I believe that it will be, but it's a sort of work in progress. This is all showing literally that considering the richness of the area of structure richness, this random. Results are sort of modest. It's sort of in a certain sense necessary. I think there is no way how to randomly sample the class which would be nowhere dense or which would have a bounded expansion. But it's not true actually. Maybe this is not the right question. The right question is that these nowhere dense classes provide a proper setting for converging first order probabilities. And in fact, you can have, this is leading to the, as I said before, to the analytic definition of this dichotomy between nowheredance and sparse dense. Something has a nowheredance if and only if every converging sequence, first order converging sequence, has a modeling limit, as we recently. So this is, and this is of course pure random setting, but this is another story, and for that one needs a little bit more machinery, and I hope to say it next week. And thank you for attention. Thank you.